We're going to be outside today talking about freedom for Passover.
I'm checking and testing, checking, testing, checking, testing, checking, testing.
Hi, this is Michelle with Life After Choice. We'll take it in small bites. Please like, share, and subscribe and do all that good stuff so we can grow our channel. I'm going to read from Isaiah 61 now. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners. In this passage, we see a messianic figure. Who is this character that seems to have been chosen and anointed by God to bring liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners? Well, interestingly, Jesus goes into a synagogue one day and reads from this very passage. And he said, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." So he identified himself with this scripture. He understood that it was speaking of his work. He is the one who gives the captives liberty and gives the prisoners freedom. When I've been around women who are suffering from the trauma of abortion, sometimes it seems as though what might have started as one sin, the sin of abortion, became a vast complex of dysfunction in their lives. It spread like a tumor, sending tentacles throughout every aspect of their lives. I get the feeling from some of these women that they are held captive, that they're in a straitjacket, immobilized, that they can't be themselves, that they don't have freedom. And that word freedom is the word that comes to mind when I think about, well, how would I pray for this person? I would love to see this person have freedom from bondage. They seem to be in a spiritual state of slavery, bondage. For that reason, today, because it's Passover, I want to speak a little bit about freedom from bondage. The story of Passover begins with the birth of a deliverer. Now, there was a death sentence decreed by the Pharaoh to take the life of the Israelite children by throwing them in the Nile. But one child escaped this death sentence because his mother hid him. She built a basket of reeds. She put him out on the Nile. Of course, we're talking about Moses. But if you look at it, there's a similarity between Moses and Jesus in this regard. Jesus also was under a decree of a death sentence that was established by King Herod. When he knew that the Messiah was born, he decreed that all the children 2 years and under in the town of Bethlehem, where Jesus was born, that all these children should be slaughtered. Let's go back a little further. Why do we need a deliverer? Well, God created a perfect paradise in the Garden of Eden, where he was able to fellowship with humanity face to face. That perfect fellowship with God was broken when Adam and Eve sinned. And that sin is our heritage. It's part of our human experience now. Jesus tells us that everyone who commits sin is a slave of sin, which brings us to Egypt. Because the Israelites found themselves in bondage and slavery in Egypt. And that is a perfect teaching picture of our bondage to sin. Sin is not something that people like to talk about, but it's real. And if you've experienced being a slave to sin, as we all have, you know that sin doesn't sit still. It doesn't just stay in your pocket as a little morsel that you can dip into from time to time. No, sin wants to take over. It wants to grow. It gets bigger and bigger. And just like the Pharaoh wanted to keep the Israelites in slavery in Egypt, and he wouldn't let God's people go, God called, "Let my people go." Pharaoh hardened his heart. That's exactly what the enemy does, because he doesn't want to let you go either. He wants you to remain a slave to sin. Sin does not exist in a vacuum. It offends the holiness of God. He can't just abide with it. He can't just tolerate it and live side by side with it. He must judge it. So, what does God do in response to Pharaoh's hardened heart. He sends a series of 10 plagues. Each plague is designed to knock down one of the gods of Egypt. This is really a demonstration of God's mercy, that he would give the Pharaoh 10 chances to get it right. But Pharaoh still doesn't let God's people go, even after the first 9 plagues. And so God sends his judgment on Pharaoh in the most horrific 10th and final plague, which is the death of the firstborn. Now, this is also designed to knock down one of the Egyptian gods, because the Egyptians felt that the Pharaoh and his lineage were divine. So in taking the life of the firstborn of Pharaoh, God was saying, no, your lineage has no divinity. I am the Lord. But you might be asking, what a horrible consequence for these Egyptian people. Wasn't there some escape clause that they could somehow get away from the terrible 10th plague? And yes, indeed, there was an escape clause. God had mercy to provide it, not only for the Jewish people, but for anyone who would follow this instruction. And I'll read it to you now from Exodus 12. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, they are each one to take a lamb for themselves according to the father's households, a lamb for each household. Your lamb shall be an unblemished male, a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel is to slaughter it at twilight. Moreover, they shall take some of the blood and put it on the 2 doorposts and on the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that same night, roasted with fire, and they shall eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled at all with water, but rather roasted with fire, both its head and its legs, along with its entrails. And you shall not leave any of it over until morning, but whatever is left of it until morning, you shall completely burn with fire. Now you shall eat it in this way, with your garment belted around your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in a hurry. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will go through the land of Egypt on that night and fatally strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the human firstborn to animals. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute my judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will come upon you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. So each family was to take a lamb and live with it for 4 days. They were to make sure it was completely perfect, without blemish. And then they were to slaughter it without breaking its bones, and they were to use its blood to dab that blood on the doorposts and lintels of their houses. As long as the people stayed in that safe house that was covered in the blood of the perfect lamb, they were safe. They were not subject to the wrath of God that was coming in the form of this destroyer who was going to take the lives of the firstborn of Egypt. But if they were scoffers, didn't believe, they were out and about bumping around out there in Egypt, just on their own, then they were vulnerable, because the judgment of God was going to come on them and they would have no protection against it. You see, the blood was the protection. The people that we read about in the New Testament certainly made the connection between the Passover lamb and the Lamb of God, Jesus. What did John the Baptist say when he welcomed Jesus before his baptism? He said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And what did the Apostle Paul say? He said, "Christ, our Passover, also has been sacrificed." So let's make some of those connections. Like the Passover lamb, Jesus was without blemish. Like the Passover lamb, none of Jesus's bones was broken. Like the Passover lamb, which was treated as a whole burnt offering. Remember, whatever they didn't eat in the morning, they had to burn it up until it was nothing but ashes. So the same was the case with Jesus, who gave all of himself. He was a whole offering. Like the Passover lamb, the blood of Jesus protects us from the wages of our sin, which is death. Like Moses, who led the children of Israel out of bondage in Egypt, Jesus leads us to freedom, out of bondage to sin. Jesus says, if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Many of us who have had abortions were sold the idea that sexual freedom was freedom. But we found out differently, didn't we? There were casualties involved. Not only casualties in the child that was lost, but how about all those disappointing relationships that didn't follow through? Because all you were looking for on both sides, or maybe just on one side, was a momentary pleasure that came and it didn't last too long and then it left. Where was commitment? Commitment was not to be found. Where was lasting love? Lasting love was not to be found. Where was heroism, honor, sticking with someone, love, developing a relationship? Where was commitment? Those things were not a part of the picture of sexual freedom. And many of us have discovered that sexual freedom was actually a form of slavery. It certainly was not freedom. What is real freedom then? Real freedom is when you know that you've done unspeakable wrongs, but you humble yourself before God, you pray, you seek His face and turn from the bad things that you've done in your life. We call them wicked ways. And God hears you. You ask His forgiveness and He gives it to you. And then all of a sudden, this straitjacket that we talked about is loosened. You're no longer captive. You can actually be yourself. You have this profound gratitude and joy that you've been forgiven for what you consider to be something that could never be forgiven. The prison doors are flung open. That ugly tumor of sin that we talked about is just lifted right out of you. It becomes nothing. You're free. You're free of it. You can be yourself. You can move your arms. You can speak. You can rejoice and just express the wonderful gratitude and joy of having been forgiven and knowing that that Passover lamb did something for you that you could never do for yourself. God's firstborn son took upon himself the judgment that was to fall on the firstborn in the land of Egypt so that we could live. That Passover lamb and his blood applied to your heart frees you from the consequences of all your acts, all the regrettable stuff, all the messes we've made. It's all under the blood. That's what we talk about, under the blood, because it's under that doorpost that's covered with the blood so that the destroyer passes over. Now, what does that also mean? It means that we have life. This forgiveness from Jesus gives us new life. We are a new creation. We are no longer enslaved. We are a free people. And because Jesus rose from the dead and conquered death entirely, that gift is also ours. So when that destroyer passes over, the world may die, but the believer in Yeshua will never die. This is freedom. Let's go back to Isaiah 61 and read a little bit more about what this freedom means for us. We'll use this as our closing prayer. We will be given, Isaiah 61 says, a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a spirit of fainting. So they will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that He may be glorified. Then they will rebuild the ancient ruins. They will raise up the former devastations, and they will repair the ruined cities, the desolations of many generations. Instead of your shame, you will have a double portion. And instead of humiliation, they will shout for joy over their portion. Everlasting joy will be theirs. That is what the Passover lamb has done for believers. Thank you so much for joining us today. We'll see you next time.